Okay, welcome to game one, the Moray Cup 2016. First Dogs versus Itari. I'm General Jivikis, and I'm going to be joined once again by Sam Wise in the commentator's box here. Sam Wise has a bit of insider knowledge on First Dogs, so we'll get his insights into their draft and maybe some comments about their previous game. I don't know if he's up to date on what happened there, but we'll see how it goes. So, first bans though, Undying getting banned out by First Dogs. They had a punishing two games against, in their previous set there against Team Binbag. Undying being picked up in both those games. Don't think they want to face him again tonight. Bans though for Itari. Witch Doctor are taken out of the pool, and also Gyrocopter. Any idea what First Dogs might ban next, Sam?
I'm not sure really, it matters what they're feeling they want to pick here. But as we can see, yeah, the Undying obviously not comfortable with that one against coming up against that. And there's the two strong laners in both Witch Doctor and Gyro. And there's the Invoker ban, so obviously consider Invoker so strong even with its recent nerfs, that's not it's surprising.
No, that's kill banned once again. 90% ban rate, 95% ban rate, I think, in the tournament overall so far. No one wants to go up against competent Invokers. I'm not sure how Itari play Invoker, though. I've not really had much chance to look into their drafting so far. But they do pick up the Shadow Shaman. Maybe going to be seeing an early push strategy from them.
I can't remember which player, but I'm pretty sure one of the Itari players plays Invoker, so that might be a targeted ban if they've done any research. But yeah, Shadow Shaman, nice early push, but good lockdown as well, so it's a decent pickup.
I'm guessing it might be Beacon of Knowledge, given the fact that he's got Invoker there as his profile picture.
Dire team. That might have something to do with it.
We've got Darkseer, though, picked up for the off-lane on First Dogs. He is such an awesome off-laner. Able to zone out with Ion Shell and actually pick up levels and experience. They did have a bit of a few problems, I think, running 3-1-1 against Team Binbag, and then I think they tried a 2-1-2 in the second game, but that didn't go so well either. First game though was a pretty good showing for First Dogs, I think.
5 seconds
pretty
remaining.
Close game in the early game anyway. But just weren't quite able to deal with Team Binbag's insane early game push in both games. And also, Team Binbag's really drafted around a really good team fight. The Disruptor picked up. I really love Disruptor. He is such a great support. The Glimpse and the Party Ring, able to zone out really well there. Probably put that in the safe lane to support whatever they pick up for the carry. Venge picked up for Itari as well, so that's going to be both their supports, I expect, already picked up. So that leaves them with three cores. I mean, that's that's going to be tough, especially if they pick up something with, you know, a strong right-click. Venge together can be pretty potent there.
Well, that'll be a crackpot Darkseer, I'm pretty certain. He's fairly solid on the hero. And it might be a kid Disruptor is what I'm feeling. Possibly Fazzle, but the crackpot Darkseer is fairly strong still the lane, so I think we'll probably be seeing a tri-lane top from Oddpot. I can't remember read inside. Tri-lane anyway from the First Dogs here.
Yeah, I think Crackpot actually really played some decent offlane plays, and I mean the kid was making plays left, right, and centre. I think he got 3 or 4 $6 million slams with the Earthshaker in game one. Spirit Breaker, I don't feel he was aggressive enough with the Spirit Breaker in the second game. I don't think he was able to kind of capitalize on the mid gank potential. But obviously, with Team Binbag running the 2-1-2, there was no opportunity for him to pick on their offlane at all. But Zeus banned out there, they're going to probably feel that a little bit. Will we see another Fazzle Dazzle?
Well, Fazzle Dazzle is, as you say, very strong. But also, going back to this Darkseer pickup, it works quite well against the Venge, because any wall, you'll get the Venge Aura as well. So from the illusion, so it's a fairly useful pickup actually there.
Yeah, of course, all of the passives etc. that you get from the illusion. There. So if you do pick up any items like a Vlad's or you know the pipe or Shiva's or anything like that on the on Team Itari, Darkseer will be able to take advantage of that with the wall. Silencer banned out then by First Dogs. Certainly does look like they've done their research for this match.
10 seconds remaining.
So both heroes picked up so far are fairly spell heavy, so remaining. you got to take out that silencer if you're wanting a spell heavy lineup.
Reserve time.
Ooh, Earthshaker banned out there. I wonder if they're aware of I mean, obviously, with Crackpot on the Darkseer and maybe that Disruptor pickup for the kid. Well, don't know. We'll wait and see whether or not that does go the way of the kid. But yeah, obviously, his Earthshaker was pretty potent. And they've kind of spotted out that if the Earthshaker's been banned out, they might be considered an Illusion Hero. That still leaves Naga, obviously, on Chaos Knight, which could be problematic, despite the Phantom Lancer ban there. I don't know how you feel about Chaos Knight as an early push hero. I mean, certainly if you can pick up drums on Chaos Knight. A lot of people rush different items, but if you pick up drums, it kind of addresses his mana issues and it allows him to play a little bit earlier. A little bit earlier reserve on time. In the game.
Can be a good early pusher, but most people do seem to tend to play him up until maybe 12, 13 before they start putting points in his ultimate, so it depends how he's played, though, so obviously he can be early pushing power.
Crystal Maiden then for Fazl. I expect, as you said, obviously Dire Kid probably going to be on Disruptor. Safe lane carry, do you think, for Juggernaut there? I mean, he can go mid as well. Really versatile hero, obviously with a healing ward there, he does have the sustain in lane. Pretty farm heavy though, he wants to pick up that Battle Fury before he actually starts to do any work. Ooh, Slark safe lane then. Do you
Radiant
think it'll be Slark
team
safe lane?
Pick.
Or Slark mid? I'm not sure, is that something WoW would play?
Well, no, I'm pretty sure that's a WoW hero. He's big on his Slark plays, he's enjoyable with that. And also the Crystal Maiden, I feel we're going to be, definite kid hero, so Disruptor will be end up being Fazl, I'm pretty sure, and yeah, that'll be the Jug and the Venge go fairly well in a dual lane, even a tri lane, so that's pretty good, and the Ogre, I'm guessing, is the off lane here.
Yeah, Ogre off lane, so a lot of disables coming out for Team Itari. Slark obviously has his Pounce, Crystal Maiden has the Frostbite, Disruptor's got the Party Ring, no hard stuns though. For first dogs yet, and a lot of stuns coming across from the Venge. The Shadow Shaman has the Shackles and the Hex, as well as the Fire Blast.
Radiant
on
team ban.
DP taken out of the mid options. They're definitely looking for a mid hero on Itari now, so probably quite a smart ban given the fact that Invoker's out, but OD is still in the pool, and I'm curious to see whether or not they pick up on that.
10 seconds remaining.
Yeah, they've not got much lockdown on first dogs here in terms of stuns, but they have got the lockdown of each hero has their own sort of control spell, as I'd call it, rather than lockdown. So it's not too bad, but yeah, there's a lot of lockdown there on the Itari, which can be very dangerous with the Juggernaut spin early game, so I think a Crackpot on the Darkseer might have to watch out for that.
Yeah, and early rotations, obviously Slark can be really, really dangerous unless you can get lockdown on him. I mean, even then, with the Dark Pact, if you pop it slightly beforehand, he can break out of the Shackles there for sure. And, I mean, that's going to be something, hopefully, that we'll see WoW pulling off.
No AoE stun as well on Itari here, so once he's popped off his ult there on Slark, he's pretty much unstoppable until he's back out. So that could be a problem for them here if they don't sort that out.
I mean, taking that into account, I mean, could we even see maybe a Warlock mid here or something like that? Oh, Shadow Fiend banned out. Okie dokie.
Dire team
more mid heroes going down. Obviously, both teams waiting to pick their mid here. The advantage going to Itari, obviously, as First Dogs will pick up their mid first. And that will give Itari a few seconds there just to kind of to counter whatever they do pick up or try to semi-counter it anyway.
See what we picked up for Bobo here. He's a fairly good mid hero. I've seen him play a fair few heroes, and he's solid on most of them. But now I'm interested to see what's going to be picked up here, especially with the Zeus ban, because he's a fairly solid Zeus player.
Yeah, he played Zeus in one of the previous matches there, and he was really able to keep up as far as farm was concerned there. Why are we not quite able to find the same level of farm, though, as the safe lane farmer for Team Binbag? And even with the tri lane in place, he was zoned out pretty hard in both matches. I mean, how strong is WoW there, do you think, in the safe lane?
He's quite a strong player. He has his games where he's not playing quite as well, but oh, there's the Pudge. Yeah, I was gonna bring this one up. Bo plays a very, very good Roman Pudge. So I'm looking forward to seeing some players here. He's not a new pudge, he's more of an old style pudge player. But no, as we go back to WoW, he is quite a strong player. He's a lot more strong on the Slark compared to the, I think I can't remember who he played last two games because I didn't watch them or hear about them, but so I can't really comment on them. But normally he's more of an aggressive than a farm sort of hero. So Slark, I think, is definitely a better pickup for him compared to a Jug type hero here.
Yeah, he picked up Jug in the second game. In the first game, I think he had maybe a Sven. I'm not sure. No, Sven was the opposite carry.
Wasn't it? It was PL.
It was PL, yeah, but they picked it third. Which I thought was a mistake. Obviously, if you're going to pick PL, pick him last. And they were like, yeah, but we banned out all the counters, and it's like, well, you may well have thought you did, but your whole team kind of did what you had.
Well, the Legion mid is interesting. I'm guessing it's the Legion mid unless.
Well, they could put Jug mid, I guess. That's another option that they've got there. Or Ogre Magi could go mid
as well. It could be a Legion offlane. Yeah, it's sort of a very open draft here from Itari. First dogs as expected. Yeah, it'll be the kid on.
Yeah, if we go through the draft here, the kid has picked up Crystal Maiden, as you said. WoW on the Slark, Natty Bobo, as expected, on the Pudge. Fuzz on the Disruptor, and Crackpot takes the Darkseer into the offlane. Quickly having a look over at Team Itari here, we've got Pray for Too Good on the Venge, Spicy Bizzle on the Shadow Shaman, Westwold on the Ogre Magi, Sparker, as we saw, on the Legion Commander. And I think Beacon of Knowledge might be going mid with the Juggernaut. I think we saw a couple of smokes getting picked up, one for each team there. Smoke picked up by the kid there. No, only a smoke on the kid. And only one ward picked up as well. I don't know what's happening with that. One ward on either side. Three mangoes, though, for Team Itari, and two on Crackpot. He's going to have a lot of early sustain. It looks like they're going to try and wrap around here behind the first dogs. And we've certainly got a lot of first blood potential, I think.
The second ward was picked up actually on the Dark Series. Gone and warded up that safe pull camp.
First
ward I picked up.
Yeah. And Basil going to get caught here. He's kind of going to be in a lot of trouble here. He's definitely probably going to go down. I think. And that's the first blood going the way of Itari.
Not surprising. We got five men.
Taste of revenge. What savage is this?
Won't be seeing a hook here from Bo and the Pudge. Probably a bit dangerous, there's all five of them there.
Yeah, no initial setup, and you know, nobody went to the offlane, so it wasn't like he was able to do anything in there either. Pretty good creep block, though, I have to say. It's very much in his favour. We've got the Venge sitting in mid here at the moment.
Doesn't often be played, but Venge carry is quite a decent hero if played correctly. Out there by the instantly, he knows it's there.
That's I mean, he doesn't have the ward on his side, and I normally, as Pudge, I like to have a ward so that I can just throw those hooks and catch them out here. But so, Venge range hero versus Natty Bobo's Pudge here, probably not going to be looking for too many last hits though, obviously. Probably going to look more for just to get kind of kills here.
Very aggressive little players, really. I really rate this. For first time I ever played against him, we tried to play against the party and they just crushed us. Bo mid crushed us, so I'm expecting good things from here. It looks like we've got the Legion off lane as well, so very aggressive sort of lanes here from Itari.
Yeah, we got the tri lane in bottom, which is going to be a real problem for the Darks here. Obviously, he will have Surge and Iron Shell to kind of deal with that. We've got Spicy Bizzle. We've got Spicy Bizzle down there on the Shadow Shaman, Westwold, and also Beacon of Knowledge.
Yeah, but it is. I think it's going to be hard to get to XP range here for Crackpot on the Darks here. But oh, and there's something going on top. Looks like we've got possible gank coming in here.
Oh, they've wrapped around behind Sparker, and the Slark manages to land an excellent pass. Well. Glimpse in. I think they can probably get this. I mean, Crystal
might be able to body block him here if he tries to go into the trees. That might be end up being a big mistake for him. He eats his way through a couple. Have they got anything else they can get on him? Nah, he works. Run a scout there fairly well. well played there from the Legion.
Yeah, he managed to juke them there. It's unfortunate. Back... Sorry, I was just going to say, it was unfortunate the kid didn't have his, he didn't have his frostbite there. He managed, he used it once, yeah. But he wasn't able to get another one off.
Yeah, didn't quite have the mana for it. But yeah, going back to the bottom lane, I'd say the Darkseer will be able to get last hits fairly okay with the Darn Shells, hopefully. But levels might be quite hard against this sort of lineup. He's going to have to play very safe to ensure that he doesn't give easy kills to the Jug, because you really don't want the Jug to be able to snowball into that Battle Fury type build.
He will obviously be able to use the new hard camp just up here, just to farm up some XP if he isn't able to get anything from the lane.
Denied. Did take the hard camp, and also if it starts getting too bad or he gives maybe a kill or two away, you can always just rotate to the jungle and leave Jug down there.
Dangerous though to give him such an early free lane. Obviously the ion shell spam. They only have one ranged hero in that safe lane, and I think they're going to realize now. This ward, obviously, with it being placed there early, they're going to be aware that the camp is blocked, and they're not going to be able to pull anything back. So I mean, that's a really good move by Crackpot. I think he played that in both the previous matches as well. Just blocking that camp allows him to actually get within the XP range, and hopefully maybe pick up some levels. Last hits though, if you look at mid lane, the Venge versus Pudge, only 6 last hits going the way of the Pudge, 12 on the Venge, so pretty much roughly double the actual last hits going the way of the Venge in mid there. And this looks like we've got a smoke wrap round though from the Kid and Fazzle. Venge is not really in a great position just yet. He needs to kind of wait for him to come forwards. They are aware that they're missing from top.
I think Venge has sort of figured this out. He seems to be playing fairly carefully. He's not got a ward in place that'll be able to spot them, but he's playing carefully enough to realise what's going on. And he might have been able to see the smoke from... No, he wouldn't have been able to see that smoke there. Odd double ward here, mid from the Itari.
Yeah, well, the high ground ward is just specifically for the positioning of the Pudge Hook. And that second one up there catches the vision on the top rune there. But yeah, heavy investment. They really don't want to be caught out by the Pudge Hook there. Sporker need to be careful. The Kid's come around behind him, and he does prop the frostbite, but there's no follow-up. So he's just going to have to use it to zone him out.
They'll have to stay in lane with the Slark just till he picks, manages to pick up that level 6, because the harass from the Legion is fairly substantial. So he just needs to make sure that he can. The Legion's going to pick up a mid an invis rune here, which could be quite dangerous. I'm not sure. I think the ward on the Dire Ward should be able to pick that up though, so they should see that he's got that invis rune bottled up.
Radiant structures are fortified. Yeah, they're gonna notice that surely. He has also gone for a 2-2 O build, so he is able to throw in a lot more harass than we normally see from the Legion Commander with the overwhelming odds. Used up all his mana there though, so he is going to have to pop that Illusion rune, the Invis rune, before he's able to start getting his mana back. And again, we got Fazzle coming around the back here, and maybe Sporker a little bit too far, a little bit too deep at this point. There is a Frostbite. Fazzle's here, hopefully he's got the party ring this time. He just leveled it up just for this fight. This could be really good, but the Invis rune, no dust, no sentry wards, unfortunately for them. He's going to be able to walk off. And meanwhile, Nighty Mobile gets picked off by Vengeful Spirit in the mid.
Just such a strong hero early on with both three levels of Magic Missile and the Wave of Terror. He can just hit so hard with those stuns, and it's quite a dangerous hero.
No points in the Vengeful Aura just yet, though.
He's figured out with his Wave of Terror, the minus armor is enough to make sure he doesn't really need that extra damage.
Well, Pudge obviously not a very high armor hero starting out anyway. He needs to get items if he does want to build up any kind of armor at all. A gift from the goddess. A As far as the safe lanes go, though, I mean, it seems like WoW is much more comfortable, as you said, on this hero, because he is managing to match the Juggernaut's last hits here. Oh my god, Venge picked up Pudge again in the mid lane there. I really need to keep an eye on that. That's twice now that he's kind of gone down there and missed it. That's unfortunate. There is a nice lane ward here as well by Sporkar, so he is going to be able to spot any movement if they do push in deeper.
We didn't need...
Shut up and say thank you!
Crackpot doing well though to not feed any kills to the Dazzle and still managed to pick up a bit of farm on level 4 there. I looked like he'd eaten one of his mangoes, did he?
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
He had his clarity there, not a mango.
Yeah, he still has both.
Possible gank bot here with Bo and Dazzle both TPing in.
They're gonna know. I mean that's a fairly obvious gank though, obviously, with Natty Bobo being there. For the longer he's there, the more obvious it's gonna be that something's amiss at mid. And it does leave the Venge to free farm there, and she certainly is taking advantage of that at the moment.
Dire's middle tower.
Misses, and Crackpot gets caught out by the fire blast. The shackles comes to nothing though, and it looks like Spicy Fizzle might go down.
There we go. Natty Bobo's gonna be happy with that. Ion Shield plus the Rot, and we might get a couple here with the glimpse back as well. Looks like we've got a triple. Three kills nice. There, they're very well played with the Ion Shield and the Rot.
They destroyed that safe lane there. Rotation successful. A lot of damage on the mid tower out of that though. I mean, but they're going to be quite happy with that trade. I don't imagine they're going to be too bothered. Obviously, like I said before, Pudge is going to rely more on his roaming kills in order to get leveled up and get farm. It looks like Venge's first item is going to be a mechanism.
Looks like a sterling mech pick up, but you see from quite a few heroes. Not quite sure how it goes with Venge, as I've never really not played that much carry Venge myself, but it seems a fairly solid pickup for any hero in a team.
Oh, and Natty Bobo taking so dangerous. Much punishment. Just a quick swap out, bad positioning from the kid there, allowing the Venge just to swap out of the party ring
Dire's
and
top tower
get
is under
back
attack.
To safety.
Yeah, very quick thinking there from the Venge to swap out. It was a fairly decent play.
And Juggernaut picked up the kill on Darkseer in the safe lane there, so that's unfortunate. That gain that they made with that triple kill, kind of slipping away there just with some misplays and positioning.
First item here on the Juggernaut though with the Vlad pickup. Not quite sure about that.
Oh, and a little hook fish by Natty Bobo. Not quite finding anyone. Pretty close though. And the kid just spamming out the. We got a dual top here. Would have been really dangerous.
Doesn't quite manage
to
get him though.
If they'd managed
to get his.
If WoW had got the
damage,
the kid
got stopped
to
fight off.
Fresh meat.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Meanwhile though, Crackpot caught out again in the bottom lane. A swap back in by Pray for Too Good. And Natty Bobo, he's going to fall as well. The damage on this Venge is quite appreciable, I have to say.
Just with that full points and wave of terror, you really start doing some serious damage to these low armed heroes.
Dire's structures are fortified.
Yeah, I don't know if Pudge maybe wants to pick up something with a little bit of armor on it to deal with that.
Juggernaut!
Obviously, having the Venge there, does she have any points in her aura yet? But certainly the Vlads
Dire's
will be giving them all a damage boost anyway. 15% melee damage boost there. Attack damage boost even. And Natty Bobo and Crackpot going to have a little go here for the Venge. This could be a huge kill for them. If they can get this Venge here right now,
there's the wall
swaps
as well.
In the beacon of knowledge, and Natty Bobo manages to deny himself. The party ring is in place, and there is a wall, but I don't know if they can draw any more heroes through it at the moment.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
This thing and pull them all back in there. Going toe to toe with Sparker once again. Really dangerous, obviously, to duel the WoW there. He's going to be able to build up some. Nah, he's going to go down. Disastrous.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
So they did manage to pick up both Disruptor and Slark on the back of that team fight there. Sparkart's jewel just keeps Slark in place too often for too long. He wasn't able to get the damage onto the jab. They're going to push in here right into the tier 2. I think they feel fairly comfortable being able to push here.
Expanding the surf reward, so.
Yeah, surf reward's not been used yet, so.
Can't play, think, with it. Not thinking they require it. Good hook to here, though.
Yeah, we can maybe get a return kill. Yeah, we got a return kill, but Disruptor does go down in the back here. But I would trade Disruptor for Juggernaut 9 times out of 10, I have to say. That's a really good trade for them. Spicy Bizzle gonna get caught out as well. That's gonna be the two spots.
Wow, he might get a kill.
Yeah, wow with the Ion Shell. Obviously the high movement speed on Slark allowing him to pursue down on not only those dangerous right clicks and pounds, but the Ion Shell damage just doing so much to secure the kill there. But Pray for Too Good has moved up top here, and he was looking to push the tower, but we do have some good TP rotations in from the two supports. Nothing to kind of back them up though, so they're going to have to be careful.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
She has backed off though, back TP'd back home. Doesn't want to risk getting picked off there.
Spot up the Juggernaut rotation though, so they know he's coming in.
Dire's top tower.
Yeah,
is
Juggernaut's
under
still
attack.
Managing to find his farm despite these fights here, and. Like Slark though has kind of tailed off for just now. He's not been able to find any more farm. We're looking for kills though. Obviously he wants to roam with his level 6.
He's
going to be in trouble here. The Omni Slash going to be too much for them.
My finest work.
Yeah, just kind of taken out there and deleted. Slark though looking to pick up the beacon knowledge here. Venge is nearby though. They're going to have to be careful. He gets caught out by the fire blast and immediately jeweled by Sparkart.
No.
The wind goes the way of Sparkar, but he does get caught out by Naive Bobo on Crackpots here as well. Iron shell, but he does manage to have an Iron Shell onto Pudge, which secures the kill for Naive Bobo on the Ogre Mage. Juggernaut though finishes up Naive Bobo. So they end up trading 3 for 2, but at this point in the game I think that's a pretty good trade. Given the fact that the XP and gold
difference
here,
middle tower
I
is
think
under
probably
attack.
Traded almost even there as far as gold and XP goes.
Itari taking a 7,500 gold lead and about a 5,000 XP lead here, so it's quite substantial with all the towers they've managed to push especially.
Yeah, tower damage in particular, obviously,
it's
going to pass gold to the whole team there, and it will give you the big run. Crystal Maiden, the king throws down her ult, but the kid is not able to get anything done there, and it looks like Natty Bo are going to get caught out with another jewel, more damage from the way Sparkart. Croc Pop picks off as well. I don't know, I think First Dogs might have been shaken by their 2-0 defeat earlier, and it's really kind of shown here. Itari, obviously, first game of them, first game for them in the tournament, looking to make a statement, to make a mark,
are fortified.
And see about get some points in their group.
Dire's top tower is under attack. Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Quite a solid group this, but a few 4k, 4-3k teams in this group, so I think we might possibly see a possible winner from one of these groups here, from this group here.
Yeah, I was really impressed with Team Bidbag earlier, I have to say. And Itari are proving themselves to be quite formidable as well. Minutes in and all of the tier ones are down for First Dogs.
Yay!
Only one tier 2 left. And that was a misplay
by
Kid
on the disruptor.
Wow, just trying to find some farm, trying to find some items. There's the first ward. This tower will have no chance though. I mean, we've got Venge Aura, we've got the Vlad's Aura, we've got the damage on the Legion and on the Juggernaut. There's going to be a problem for Crackpot as he gets swapped back in and dueled. Brave Cupid though, caught out once again by the Pudge Hook. Natty Bobo doing some work there. and they do trade evenly. Darkseer off lane for the mid. They lose a tower, but I mean, again, not the worst of trades for not the worst of trades for First Dog there.
I'll take that as tribute.
They're going to go for a Roche here, and it's going to be so easy. Without the Venge, though, they don't have the minus, minus armor on.
Hook up here from Team First Dog, so they know what's going on. They're pretty much down, and it's sort of an all or nothing play, I think, here.
And they're coming for it now, yep. He wasted the shackles on the Roche. The party ring is there. They're not going to be able to get out. They do hook out Westwald here. Sporkar are going to come into the ult, but it's too slow. Sporkar picks up more dual damage and Fossil going to go down as well.
You should be honored.
And I think we're going to get Ben showing up here fairly shortly, so this Roche is not going to be a problem anymore. Natty Bobo looking to get another hook though. No blinks though, so no chance of them getting in there and picking up
the Roshan
Aegis.
Has fallen to the Radiant.
Immortality.
We could be looking at one of the shortest matches of the tournament, just with the way things are set up at the moment. Certainly feel like Itari could push high ground, but as far as the lanes are concerned, only bottom lane, obviously the one that they're pushing right now, is in a position for them to get in there. But once they get in the base, they could certainly rotate round, and they have a lot of early sustain, obviously, with the Jug Ward. I didn't notice if the mech had been picked up yet. The mech obviously was picked up
Dyer's
early by Itari on the bench, so they have that, and there's the ward
Radiant's
getting
middle tower is under attack.
Nobody there to counter the wards. Oh, nice! Bobo caught out by the level 11 Juggernaut's level 2 Omni Slash, just removing him completely there.
Dyer's bottom
no
floor
stuff
is
obviously available. We had to do stuff actually, just another jewel onto Disruptor, easy jewel there, picks up some more damage, and that's going to be a whole set of racks.
Dyer's bottom barracks has fallen. Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Over the second here, they're just trying to finish the game nice and early, because against that, it's not looking promising for First Dogs here.
Middle tower has fallen.
Any thoughts on what First Dogs could take from this? Maybe look at
Dyer's
some heroes that they want to ban out, or heroes they can pick up to deal with this super early push they've got here. That's a really good wall there at the moment, but again, Crackpot, he's not combining his vacuum well with the wall there. He's not putting as many illusions out of it as he could do. There is an illusion from Benz though, so that'll be doing work. Juggernaut though, just too strong, too early on here. Fazl going to pick up the overmage kill on the backside here, and wow, in a little bit of trouble. Somebody must have a medallion, do they know that's the wave of terror?
Dyer's middle barracks are under attack. Dyer's middle barracks has fallen.
Well, I was just trying desperately to
game this, I think. Yeah, I think from what I can tell, it looks like Team First Dogs need to really counter the early game there. I think they're probably a more strong late game sort of team, so I think they definitely need to try and counter the early game push that we're seeing from both teams they come up against here.
Oh, without a blink in from Beacon of Knowledge, he's just going to spin in and kill Fazl. There's nothing they can do, obviously, he's Magic Beam. They're going to catch him here on the back end, but his Aegis is down, actually, so... Ah, no, the Omni Slash is back up, and he does get the kill, though. Natty Bobo taking that godlike streak from the Beacon of Knowledge. 1,285 gold going his way, and a fair bit of gold and XP going the way of Crackpot as well. The tower's going to fall, though. These racks are exposed. And they're going to keep going into this. Sporkar must have a fair bit of dual damage by now, and they feel confident that they can deal with this. They're focusing the melee racks as well. Okay, we've got a nice switch into ult from Pudge, and we got the party ring as well. Sporkar can go down here. He does go down. And Pray for Too Good going to go down as well, with Natty Bobo managing to get the deny there. And the kid is here, and if he just pops his ult, he's kind of caught by the shock a little bit. Wow's going to save the day, And the Glimmer Cave up on the kid. The party ring's there, but probably not the greatest position. Wyo is just going to chase this down, though. If the kid has his frostbite off screen, which he does, they're going to find Westworld here. And that's going to be a team wipe for Itari. And certainly going to feel good about that for First Dogs. I mean, given the situation that they were in, they have lost an awful lot, but that's got to feel good, man, just to kind of get a little bit of their dignity back, and a lot of gold and farm going their way there. Maybe get some of their key items, their early items.
We get a glimpse into what they can do when they hit all their combinations, and they're such a new team, only started, I think, playing as a team a couple, maybe a month ago max, just before the tournament started getting organized, so I think we can expect to see more things from in the future.
Yeah, and I mean, even if they don't do too well in the group stage here, we could certainly see, with these kind of plays that they're able to pull off, we could certainly see them doing okay in the lower bracket. And who knows, they're not down and out just yet. Mech finally picked up on Shocker. He's also able to finish 4 staff at the same time. That's how much gold he got out of that set of team fights there.
It's quite a decent amount of gold there on the Disruptor.
Venge though, picking up the Solar Crest. Spicy Fizzle then, in a little bit of trouble, but why are we going to have to back off the Jewel on Kid? And that's going to be a problem. There is an Aldo on Westworld from the Disruptor, and the wall combo there together. He's going to go down. There's a new set of wards though. These racks are going to go down. And I think basically, First Dogs are just going to have to call GG. They're down to Mega Groups now. And that's almost a team wipe there. Nani Bobo though, looking for the cheeky hook into the fountain. I'm not sure whether or not he'll be able to find it. Just how dangerous that would be. They're going to rotate now. Team Itali are going to rotate round now. They only have one tower left to go, and they do have the Megas. Oh, Nani Bobo, no! Good glimpse though. Allows him to get back to the fountain and start to heal up a little bit. Not much they can do here though. Slark not back to 15. Also not back. Got a little ult there from Natty Bobo onto the Beacon of Knowledge. It's not going to be enough. The rocks will go down.
Get to see Fazzle steal some of Legion's items there at the end. Legion trying to taunt them with items and Fazzle just goes and picks them up.
Very nice, very nice. Okay, well guys, that was Itari.
Nice win there for Itari.
Yeah, Itari versus First Dogs. Take the first set and join us in a few minutes. We'll see how game 2 goes.